Thank you for watching the Tank Museum's YouTube channel, and don't forget to subscribe. This tank chat is going to be about this vehicle, the IKV-91, a Swedish tank destroyer, sometimes called a light tank, from the Cold War era. Now, we've already done a tank chat on the S-Tank, where I've talked a little bit about the situation Sweden was in post-World War II, the fact it's an independent country, it's trying to build up its own defence industries, it wants to keep its independence, it's not part of NATO, but it still sees one of its greatest threats is basically the Soviet Union, Warsaw Pact countries. Now, if you look at that S-Tank video, we talk about that, but we also talk a little bit as well about this idea of Sweden, one of the issues it's facing that makes some of its design different from other nations, Western nations in particular, building vehicles, is this idea about its terrain and its climate. And that heavily influences the design of this IKV-91 vehicle. IKV-91, infantry, cannon, Wagen, 91 because it's a 90 millimeter gun, the one it's the first time a 90 millimeter gun is going in service on a vehicle. Now, the specification for this vehicle is issued by the Swedish military, the design for this vehicle in the mid 1960s. And they're looking at a tank destroyer that they can add to the infantry brigades for protection, if you look at it that way, or the tank destroying capability. And much debate between, you know, what's really a tank, what's a tank destroyer. In the Second World War, the American General McNair, he pushed forward the idea that tanks are really there for exploitation. If attacking tanks come the other way, your own tanks should not be necessarily there to deal with that, even though they may have to at times. It's really what you want is a good anti-tank gun on a fast carriage to get to where the problem is. So a mobile anti-tank gun, really. And that leads to what the Americans design as the tank destroyer command, strike, destroy, etc. Now, that idea of a mobile fast chassis, it's taken up, other countries have already got this idea in a way, the Germans, if you think of Panzerjäger or the development of the Sturmgeschütz into an anti-tank capability. That idea that not every armoured vehicle has to have very thick armour or has to play the role of the tank, even though, and you look at the IKV-91, sometimes it's later described as a light tank. It's got all the features we normally associate with a tank, apart from perhaps for a main battle tank in the post-war era, the heavy armour protection. So this idea of the tank destroyer, it's going to be going with the infantry. It's going to be able to give them, as a specification from the Swedish military demand, it's got to be able to confront any known armoured vehicle coming the other way, basically, at the time. Now, they put out that specification. 14 different designs are submitted from three different companies. That's then narrowed down to they have a closer look at three designs, and the winner is the design put forward by the Haglunds company. Now, Haglunds, previously a major steel manufacturer out in Sweden, what they do is they start getting into making turrets for certain vehicles. Then from 57 onwards, they become really a defense company. They are making for the Swedes the PBV 301 and 302 armored personnel carriers. Now, they take some of the drivetrain, the gearing, some of the components from the armoured personnel carrier, and they put that into the design that's submitted for the IKV-91. And that's the design that is accepted. By 1970, about three prototype vehicles have been built. They're heavily tested. More prototypes come early in the 1970s. And it's actually put into production as a vehicle for the Swedish military from 1975. They're being built till about 78. And about 211 of these IKV-91s are actually built overall and put into service. They do look to the sales market. At one point, India and America have a look at the IKV-91. They come up with a version with a 105mm gun on instead, but there are actually no other foreign sales. So it's only Sweden that actually uses this vehicle. Now, what do you get with an IKV-91 then? So if we start with that gun, The gun is specially designed by Bofors, and it's a low-pressure weapon. And the advantages of a low-pressure gun, it means that barrel life is much, much longer. The stresses and strains in terms of mounting compared to a high-pressure gun where you've got massive amounts of recoil, etc., that the vehicle has to absorb, they pretty much go down an awful lot or almost out the window. So with this new 90mm gun, it fires two types of ammunition, or natures, as different ammunition types are called. It fires a heat round, high explosive anti-tank, in other words, the hollow charge type round for armor penetration, and that leaves the barrel at about 800 meters a second. It also fires high explosive rounds. They leave the barrel at about 600 meters a second. And that basically, those two speeds sound fast relative to a high velocity gun, very, very slow comparatively. So you don't have those buildups of pressures. You don't have, as I mentioned, that barrel wear, and you don't have problems about recoil, which means your vehicle can be a lot lighter. But heat rounds, again, very popular in the 60s and 70s. That idea, that's the type of armor piercing round by using chemical energy. That's the type of round you're going to be firing. So those two ammunition types go with this gun. 59 rounds are carried. They could fire about up to 18 rounds in a minute with a good, well-trained crew. The gun has a fume extractor halfway down the barrel. Early models didn't have the thermal sleeve. They later put the thermal sleeve on to try and keep the heat temperature in that barrel the same. 59 rounds, as I was saying, inside the vehicle in about three different positions. Fired by a gunner who sits on the other side of the turret from where I'm standing, commander behind him, loader on this side of the turret. And the gunner has a times 10 periscopic sight. He's got a laser rangefinder, and there's also an onboard, for the time, very sophisticated gunnery computer system. And the idea is the commander and the gunner, they can input data such as wind condition, weather conditions, etc. Some of that's manual inputted, some of it later on is done automatically. So an effective 90mm low pressure gun to give it that ability to take out enemy targets, which is its key role. In terms of its own defense, the armor is relatively light. They aim to, with this welded steel hull, they aim for it to be proof against about 20, 25 millimeter incoming armor piercing cannon rounds, but that's about it. So it is a light vehicle. It comes in at about 16.5 tons, thin armor, but how they try and up that armor level protection, it's obviously got this very nice angular looking shape. So you've got that to add to the amount of steel that's going to have to be penetrated. And they double skin the vehicle. So they actually have two layers, and they use the gap in between. So that helps protect against heat rounds, but they use that internal gap between the two layers of metal for stowage, whether it's fuel or other bits and pieces. So there's an outer skin and a thicker inner skin in terms of the armor protection on this vehicle. Now, to power the vehicle, mobility is and its ability to cross terrain is going to be one of its greatest features, because that again is looked at as it's one of its defense features. So in the back, they put a Volvo 120 Penta TD engine. It's basically a turbocharged diesel engine in the back that gives about 330 horsepower. And they angle the engine across the engine bay at the rear to shorten the length of the vehicle. If it'd been straight with its gearbox on the end, it's a Detroit gearbox they put on there, that would make it just even that much longer. Because when you look at this vehicle, it's surprisingly large. When you're calling it things like a light tank, etc., 3 meters wide, you know, this is quite a large vehicle for its role. So wherever they can, they're trying to lighten it, trying to make it more mobile, and that power to rate ratio, you know, you're getting about 20 horsepower a ton there, that's actually very good. The engine power goes through that gearbox to rear drive sprockets. It's got six double road wheels down the side, relatively wide track, single pin M20 track. This is gives a very good level of travel, in the sense there's less vibration, It's got bushing on that single pin track, which means basically that the vibration is taken down. And that, for the crew conditions, is good because you're not being rattled around all the time and the noise levels as well is kept down. So they're looking at that. It's all of this part of that design process to keep the vehicle nice and mobile. And these tracks, they will take you over because of that lightweight, semi-frozen ground. They're looking, and again, this is this other point coming back to Sweden's conditions that it's actually having to serve in. So cold, so the climate and the terrain. So this is a vehicle that's thought through in terms of where it's going to be fighting. So that issue about the temperature, that engine in the back is given a blowtorch heater, a bit like the Germans did in World War II, so you can actually set off the blowtorch, preheats the engine before you're going to start it, and they estimate they can do that down to minus 35 degrees centigrade. So that's really cold conditions before you're trying to start your vehicle. There's also an electric preheater as well because of cold conditions. This is a vehicle that could be serving in the north of Sweden with some of the infantry units there. And they're trying to think how they're looking at this is a company of IKV-91s, about 12 of them, will be issued out to each of those infantry brigades that are going to be serving around in Sweden at the time. The other issue they have to face up to, so not just the temperature, and the temperature, by the way, another one is one of the reasons the vehicle's quite wide, they try to give the crew a bit more room because the crew, if you think about it, you're going to be dressed up for the occasion, i.e. thick clothing, and they also give the crew a heater system inside as well because of some of the area they're going to be serving in. But they're also looking at the terrain. And Sweden, again, we've mentioned the idea of soft or boggy ground, hence relatively lightweight, hence a speedy vehicle for traveling along the roads. This can get up to about 65 kilometers an hour, about 40 miles an hour. So that's a good, sort of rate of knots it can move around on the roads. Off-road, very good as well. And really importantly with this vehicle, they're making it amphibious because again, with the number of lakes, inland waterways, etc., through Sweden, how are we going to get to the positions to support the infantry or take on any advancing tanks? And if you can cross water quickly without bridging, you've got an advantage there. So what they do with this vehicle, with very little preparation, you can actually put up on the front there, there's some boards that come forward that will sort of break waves coming over the front there. So they can be fitted quite quickly to help trim the vehicle that way. And on the rear engine decks, there's screens that can raise up over important points where you don't want water coming in, so your air vents or your exhaust. And with little preparation, this vehicle is then able to cross inland waterways, etc., lakes. You, again, don't really want to go on the open sea or particularly choppy conditions. And just by the tracks turning round, you can go about 6.5 kilometres an hour through the water. So again, a great advantage. The tracks as well, for particularly snowy conditions, you can add their 50 millimetre little spikes can be added to the tracks, and that will give you more purchase and grip in some types of snowy conditions. So all of these thought processes, because of the climate, because of the terrain, and of course the weapon, because of the nature of the threat, that's why this vehicle is thought through and put together in this particular manner for that very Swedish type of problem that it's facing up to. Now, on the vehicle, as you look at it at the moment, it's got this splinter pattern camouflage. Basically, Sweden was a bit late in terms of uniforms with camouflage. Their vehicles had been heavily used, different types of camouflage from the World War II era. Ultimately, this becomes the M90 splinter pattern or kind of like autumn foliage type of camouflage. There is also a winter pattern, splinter pattern as well, with lots more white in. So they're thinking of forestry, but also if you're going to paint the vehicle white, that'll be for obviously the winter snowy conditions as well in terms of the camouflage there. As you look at the vehicle, around it, it would have had two 7.62 machine guns, one coaxial, one mounted on the top, potential some sort of anti-aircraft defence there as well. We've mentioned the four-man crew, driver in the front, his hatch, his offset to the left. He, when he's driving this vehicle, behind him, he's actually got an escape hatch on the floor of the vehicle, as well as being able to come out through the front top of the vehicle there as well. And you can see his periscope arrangements, same as with the Commander. The Commander's cupola is fully rotating, and again, the Commander could be looking for targets whilst the gunner is engaging with another target again. So a lot of relatively sophisticated ideas are going on to this vehicle, even though it's only a relatively lightweight vehicle. It carries about 12 smoke discharges around the outside of the turret there, but it also carries on the top of the turret two 71mm Lyran mortars, and they basically, what they can do is they will fire illuminating shells, so again they can be fired in the air, and it basically gives you a night fighting capability by being able to illuminate the area around you if you're looking for your targets, etc. And those vehicles, those mortars actually were put on a number of Swedish vehicles. You'll see them on the S-Tank at the time as well. So overall, this is a vehicle, as we mentioned, designed very much for that Swedish type of engagement, Swedish type of problem. It sees service really to the end of the 1990s, early 2000s, it goes out of service. Number one, the threat is diminished, the end of the Cold War. Number two, like with most countries, their militaries are going down in size, so the number of infantry units that it's needed to support, and they think that support can be done by other types of vehicles, like their Leopard tanks coming into service. So they don't think they need this type of a tank destroyer in service that much anymore. So from our point of view, very grateful we were gifted this by the Swedish military. It's a really interesting vehicle to be able to demonstrate, but it shows another strand of that armoured fighting vehicle development post-World War II. This one, the idea of the tank destroyer, some other countries follow up on the tank destroyer concept, but in many ways it kind of gets diminished because of anti-tank missiles, wire-guided, etc. That type of thing tends to take over from the gun-mounted anti-tank destroyer, or the role of the main battle tank seems to take over that role, because again, that argument saying what's the best way to defeat a tank, it seems to be on the whole another tank. That's what sort of seems to take over. We have a fantastic selection of books, models, clothes and other gifts on the Tank Museum online shop. When you buy from our online shop, you are supporting the Tank Museum charity, and that means we can carry on caring for our collection and producing this content. If you have supported us already, thank you very much. Subscribe and do keep watching.